It's Friday, July the 4th, 2014. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield, and this is episode number 41 of T.E.N, Transport Evolved News, for the week beginning June 30th, 2014. Yes, okay. I know this story broke last Friday. It actually broke while we were on air, but we're including it this week in case you hadn't heard the news yet. Last week, after months of badgering from Nissan LEAF owners around the world, Nissan North America announced the outright purchase price of a brand new battery pack for the world's number one electric car. At $5,499 after $1,000 trade-in rebates, the new battery pack will breathe life into any aging Nissan LEAF and will be made from the latest Nissan lithium-ion battery technology. For those in hot climates, that's particularly important, since the replacement packs will be the so-called lizard packs, capable of withstanding the extreme heat of an Arizonan summer. The pack will fit any LEAF made from the start of production in 2010 right up to the present day models, although 2011 to 2012 model year cars will need an additional adapter to use the latest battery chemistry. Maybe there's life in that old car yet. In related news, Nissan confirmed this week that its plans from late 2012 to rapidly increase the number of DC CHAdeMO quick charge stations in the US is on track. 18 months ago, the Japanese automaker promised it would triple the number of public DC charging stations in the US from a total of 160. Now there are more than 633 units, representing more than three times the number there were. Of those charging stations, about 180 are located at Nissan dealers, while the rest are located in public spaces with easy access. That's great news for those who don't drive a Nissan LEAF but do drive a CHAdeMO-compatible car like the Mitsubishi iMiEV, because it means no one will feel bad about turning up at a non-Nissan location for a quick top-up, even if the charger says Nissan on it but their car doesn't. Do you remember the great patent giveaway of 2014? You know, when Tesla announced a few weeks back that it was making all of its electric car patents open source. Well, back then, we and a large number of other news outlets got stuck in our own little dream world, dreaming of the day when we could plug our generic electric car into the mighty Tesla supercharger network. Combine that with the news that Nissan and BMW had been in top secret talks with Tesla, and we were convinced the automotive industry world would change forever. But that's not apparently the case. Or at least, that's not what the rest of the automotive world wants you to think. You see, of the major automakers approached by Autoblog Green asking if they were interested in Tesla patents, most ignored the question altogether, with only Honda and GM even bothering to reply. Their responses? Honda said it already had the best electric car technology out there, while GM said something along the lines of, yeah, we're good. But then, if you were looking at something cool and didn't want your competitors to know, that's the kind of thing you'd say to throw them off the scent, eh? It seats two, has a tiny electric motor and almost as tiny two-cylinder diesel engine, manages about 30 miles to the charge, and has a 0-60 time that would be better suited to 1984 rather than 2014. But Volkswagen's ultra-efficient XL1 plug-in hybrid went on sale this week in the UK at an eye-watering £99,000. In case you were wondering, that's equivalent to a fully specced out Tesla Model S with room for a decent night out on the town to boot. With only 250 due to ever be made, the Volkswagen XL1 is an example of German frugality at its best. Capable of more than 250 miles per gallon, the XL1 really does sip fuel with its onboard battery pack as run out of juice. But with only 30 due to even enter the UK, don't expect this futuristic ride to be a common sight on UK roads. Instead, like XL1s elsewhere in the world, expect this ultra-exclusive car to be the preserve of design-mad car collectors, not EV nuts. Moving on to an even more expensive car, we're bringing the news that BMW North America has finally priced the i8 plug-in hybrid sports car. At $137,000, before a mandatory $950 destination and handling fee, the plug-in hybrid i8 isn't exactly cheap. In fact, it's more expensive than the perennial plug-in luxury sedan, the Tesla Model S. Unlike the Tesla Model S, however, the BMW i8 isn't really designed to be driven in all-electric mode. Instead, it uses a three-cylinder 1.5-litre gasoline engine driving the rear wheels, with a powerful 98-kilowatt electric motor driving the front wheels. All electric range is limited to about 23 miles. And frankly, from what we've heard, the BMW i8 really isn't the car for e-fans. It's the car for petrol heads who want to show they're cool and hip by including a plug-in car in their collection. Tesla's third generation electric car, the car formerly known as the Tesla Model E, won't be based on the same all-aluminium construction as its big brothers. That's according to Tesla's Vice President of Engineering, British-born Chris Porritt. Talking this week with Autocar, Porritt said that Tesla's truly affordable third-generation plug-in would need to be built with appropriate materials that were cost-effective for a mass-produced EV, hinting that the Model S all-aluminium construction would just be too expensive for the third gen. Talking of price, Porritt said Tesla was targeting the same kind of price range as the BMW 3 Series and Audi A4. Given the price range for both cars go from between $35,000 and $55,000, we're pretty excited that a Tesla might just be in the price range of many would-be EV drivers for the very first time. It doesn't matter if it's powered by electricity, gasoline, or unicorn poop. All cars in the US which go on sale must meet a minimum set of federal safety standards, known as the Federal Motor Vehicle Safety Standards, or FVMSS. While the FVMSS safety standards, which cover everything from where a car's lights need to be located to how its airbag system works, are generally mandatory, automakers can apply for specific exemptions for limited production or experimental vehicles. And this week, we learned that Toyota has done just that, filing an exemption request for FVMSS 305, a safety standard pertaining to high voltage safety disconnects in electric vehicles. Designed to keep occupants and first responders safe in the event of a crash, the law mandates all high-voltage systems have an automatic safety cutoff to kill any live power circuits, but Toyota says implementing a circuit in its soon-to-be-released hydrogen fuel cell sedan could leave the car inoperable. Instead, Toyota says it's got an alternative, which is basically loads of high-voltage insulation and metal shielding, which it will use to keep everyone safe instead, and presumably the big hydrogen bomb from actually exploding. In related news, a Toyota executive this week admitted that Toyota's hydrogen fuel cell sedan is going to be a really tough sell unless governments around the world step up to the plate with bucket loads of incentives. Worse still, Mitsushita Kato, executive vice president in charge of the company's R&D department, admitted that Toyota has no idea what type of incentive governments around the world will offer to those buying its fuel cell sedan. Currently, US and European hydrogen fuel cell incentives appear to be going along the same lines as existing plug-in car grants and rebates, something Toyota's R&D chief is concerned won't be enough to entice people to buy. And with the Toyota fuel cell sedan expected to cost around the same price as a Tesla Model S, we can't blame them either, can you? Most road opening ceremonies are pretty boring, except the ones where they have a road race beforehand, perhaps. But Nissan helped the Japanese prefecture of Kanagawa celebrate the opening of a new tunnel last weekend with style, taking not one, but two Nissan Leafs filled with autonomous drive technology along its length. Joined by Nissan top brass and Kanagawa governor Yuji Kurovaya, the autonomous Leaf tackled the inaugural tunnel driving without a hitch. While there wasn't a whole lot to see in the video accompanying the trip, we can tell you that the guy behind the wheel, the same engineer we've seen in previous videos, looks far calmer than we've ever seen him before. And that has to be a really good indication of how far the autonomous drive technology has come since we last saw it in public. Thanks to ongoing governmental support and some really proactive charging providers, the UK is now officially ahead of the rest of Europe when it comes to DC CHAdeMO quick charging capabilities. That's the official word from the CHAdeMO Association, who told us this week that of the 1,181 CHAdeMO charging stations in Europe, 239 are located in the UK, placing the island nation well ahead of its European neighbours. While the UK might have the highest number of charging stations of any country, however, Norway still wins on the number of public CHAdeMO charging stations per head population. Here's the map detailing European CHAdeMO charging station deployment. Take a look and let us know how your country is doing in the comments below. That's it for this week. Don't forget to join us next week for another episode of TEN. In the meantime, visit www.transportevolve.com for all the evolved transport news that's fit to print, subscribe to our channel and other shows on YouTube, and join us for our talk show later today when we'll be discussing these stories and others on Transport Evolved. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield, and until next time, stay juiced up!